nursing care in cirrhosis patient, first thing, what is cirrhosis? Usually, whenever patients of cirrhosis are there, you may have seen such a patients are usually like a large tummy with abdomen, fluid collection in abdomen, mostly jaundice will be there. And if you notice, examine, all these pictures will be seen. What is simply cirrhosis? Cirrhosis means patthar jeutho, heart. Cirrhosis means it is a fibrosis of liver. Cirrhosis is a permanent, irreversible, progressive damage to the liver. लिवर धीरे 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 हार्ड बनता जाता है, सो फंक्शनल कैपेसिटी चली जाती है. जैसे पर्सन वी हैव अ फीलिंग लाइक वी आर सॉफ्ट पीपल, द लिवर सॉफ्ट में से जब हार्ड बनता है तो उसका फंक्शनल कैपेसिटी चला जाता है. दिस इज अ प्योरली सिरोटिक नोड्यूलर लिवर एंड दिस इज अ स्मूथ ब्राउनिश नॉर्मल लिवर. हियर अलोंग विद दैट इज अ गॉल ब्लैडर. सो व्हेनेवर सिरोटिक लिवर इज देयर, पेशेंट विल डेवलप कॉम्प्लिकेशंस. नाउ there are two stages of liver cirrhosis. First one is a compensated, second one is a decompensated. Most of the time when patient gets admitted in hospital, they are decompensated cirrhosis of liver. Like if we have problems, we all face problems in our lifetime. Chote mote problems hote, when we have smaller problems, we try to sort out by our own. We don't go and tell each and every problem to our colleagues or teacher or maybe mother, father, brother, sister, we don't go. So that is a compensated. Small things we sort out by our own. Compensated liver cirrhosis is usually detected on ultrasound. Usually patients are asymptomatic. Patient does not have any symptoms. They are usually detected on health checkup, or many times presenting symptoms will be fatigue or weakness. Decompensated means liver is not able to perform its work, so patient will develop jaundice, ascites, encephalopathy or GI bleed, and these are the four most common indications when we admit patient. Now jaundice we all know, yellowish eyes and urine, bilirubin will go up. Ascites means fluid collection in the abdomen, there will be abdominal fluid collection. Hepatic encephalopathy means effect of rising bilirubin or reducing liver function to the brain. And GI bleed means usually they get admitted with the first GI bleed. We will go step by step what all you need to know during hospital stay of the patient. Like common causes, common causes of cirrhosis, what are the common causes? Alcohol, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, nowadays non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, Wilson disease, hemochromatosis and other causes. Most of the patients we see are alcohol, hepatitis B, hepatitis C and NASH related or cryptogenic, that we like most of the time cryptogenic cirrhosis of liver. We have not found out any specific cause. Hepatitis B and C, what are preventable? We can take, like many a time when I have come into ward for ascites taping, I have noticed that even staff forgets to wear the gloves. Don't do that mistake. Hepatitis B, we must have been vaccinated. All are vaccinated for hepatitis B?
Yes.
Sure?
Yes.
Anybody not vaccinated? See, whoever are born after 2006, they will be vaccinated as a national immunization program. But we all are mostly before 2006 born. I don't think all are more than 80. So, we all are not given vaccination unless we go and ask for vaccine or as a pre-employment, usually it is a compulsion. So hepatitis B, if you are vaccinated, all the three doses, you are usually protected. If you are protected or not, if you want to check, we can check NTHBS titer. If NTHBS titer is more than 100, then need not to worry even if you have a needle stick injury. Okay, hepatitis B will not be there to you if NTHBS titer is more than 100. But still we have to take all the universal precautions whenever a patient with hepatitis B or C is admitted, because hepatitis C is not vaccine preventable. We do not have hepatitis C vaccine up till now. So if you develop hepatitis C, there are chances that cirrhosis may develop. Although hepatitis C is very well treatable, treatment is simpler, it is not that costly. 3 months treatment, so you will be protected, you will be treated well, but then also universal precautions are necessary. Okay, and consider whenever my patients of cirrhosis are admitted, consider that if the patient is hepatitis BC positive, so you have to take care, we have to wear the gloves, don't do mistakes. Okay, indications of hospital admission, as I already mentioned, SIDs. Usually in a patient with SIDs, whenever there is a infection in SID fluid, that is spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Otherwise, pre-transplant evaluation we admit for evaluation purpose, or first time detected cirrhosis for the workup purpose we admit the patient. Upper and lower GI bleed, hepatic encephalopathy, AKI means acute kidney injury, hepatorenal syndrome, usually in that case is ICU or ward admission. Bacterial infections like urinary tract infection or pneumonia, in that case is hospital admission is required. Now SIDs you must all have seen. Usually patient comes like this, abdominal distension, SIDs is there, and many times this umbilical hernia is there. Whenever there is an umbilical hernia, ideally we should tell the patient before discharge that you need not to strain, or abdominal binder we can advise. See, many a consultant may forget, may not remember, but at the time of discharge, the patient tells you, your answer should be wear the abdominal binder or not to strain, so that this hernia rupture chance is reduced. Okay, usually what I need when patient is admitted in cirrhotic patient, what we daily weight. Even many a time I instruct them also weight is not done. Ideally in our chart only it is written daily weight should be done, but many a times it is not being done. So daily weight is necessary. Why patient is admitted in hospital at the time? Because when we give medicine, there should be weight reduction by at least 0.3 to 0.5 kilogram per day. So 300 to 500 gram weight reduction is expected whenever we are using diuretics. So, weight monitoring is necessary. What was the admission weight and discharge weight? So that whatever we have treated in hospital, was that fruitful admission, was that defective admission or not, that will be decided based on weight reduction in a patient with SIDs. Okay? Fluid liquid intake is another thing. Patient usually don't cooperate. Patient usually forget because they are ill. They want maximum care but minimum cooperation usually. But we have to explain them, we have to tell them. SIDs patients need to have fluid restriction at least 800 ml to 1.2 liter per day. Usually, whenever doctor comes for the round, you ask her how much fluid has to be given. So, fluid restriction is necessary, and that fluid includes water, liquids, juices, dahi, chas, dal, everything. Whatever is liquid form, that should be included. We need to monitor that fluid intake. That's the reason. If we monitor, then only effective weight reduction can be done during hospital stay. And urine output measurement is compulsory in a patient with cirrhosis who are admitted in the hospital. Because if that patient does not have adequate diuresis or adequate urine output, then may require SID stepping, may require nephro consultation, because if creatinine is high, we have to monitor urine output. See, if creatinine is normal and if staff tells that there is no urine output, it is completely against the lab parameter. Patient may forget, but we have to intensify every time that monitor you have to inform, you have to monitor that. Salt restriction, although dietary component, but salt restriction is always necessary. I have seen even in wards, patients do not cooperate, they get extra salt from outside family members. Salt restriction intensification is necessary. Catheter, if patient is in ward or ICU, police catheter is there, then catheter care is definitely needed. Must be known catheter care, how to take care. No patient of cirrhosis should receive uninformed NSAID, NSAIDs, by any chance. Because in a patient with cirrhosis, single tablet of brufen, single tablet of diclofenac is sufficient to cause acute renal shutdown. So by mistake even, although I have seen that here in our hospital nobody gives without confirmation, but then also many a time at midnight patient complaints of pain, do not dare to give NSAID to any patient of cirrhosis. Okay, cirrhotic patient, no NSAID group of medication. If you want, can give paracetamol 500 milligram, 1 gram without confirmation, but no NSAID by even mistake. Okay, because that one NSAID tablet will cause acute renal shutdown and may require inner dialysis. Okay, then usually SIT stepping indication for hospitalization. You say SIT stepping when there is a large SIT, huge SIT. What all things are needed during SIT stepping? I have completed 8 years in hospital. Still, when I go to ward, there are certain things not there in the wards. So, what all things will be required, that also I have kept here. SIT stepping, where do we usually do? This is the ideal location on the left side, anterior superior iliac spine, 3 cm medial and 3 cm above from anterior superior iliac spine. Okay, so that is the ideal location, which is how it is being done. Okay, what do we need usually during SIT stepping and what all things should be kept ready before SIT stepping? That is 18 gauge needle. Keep this picture in mind, 18 gauge needle. Okay, don't give blunt tipped needle. Blunt tipped needle, if we puncture anyone, it will be very painful. So, 18 gauge needle, BD set needle, in simple words, that has to be there. Then, IV set like this. With the rubber tubing here, it is usually creating difficulties. So, IV set will be required. Micropore 1 inch usually required. Ghost pieces are anywhere available in ward, sterile ghost pieces are there. Collection jar. Many times I have seen patient need 1 liter pani ki bottle. This is not the way. How they feel that 1 liter pani ki bottle patient need lena apne fluid collection ke liye. Ask nursing in charge. Make it available whenever there is a SIT stepping. You have to make it available. Okay, because it is even a source of entry of bacteria into the sterile abdominal cavity. So, sterile jar has to be there. Whenever SIT stepping is going on, many a time lignocaine local injection we need, we have to keep this ready. Whenever we are doing tapping, BP monitoring is usually required because paracentesis induced hypotension patient may develop. Okay. And most of the time, whenever I am doing tapping or whenever we have done tapping in the wards, albumin infusion is always going on, or instructions are given to give albumin infusion. So ensure that albumin is given during or post procedure or pre procedure. Okay. And post tapping leakage from paracentesis site is usually an issue. In that cases, turn the patient on the right lateral position and put a ghost piece with proper elastography or whatever a micropore application, so that leakage may not happen. These are the SIT related issues. Anybody have any questions related to that? Then we will go on one by one answer the topics. No questions. What happens whenever there is a blood in SIT stepping? We will call the doctor. First thing, usually stop tapping. We have usually kept this thing, no? The regulator will always be there. Stop that. Reduce it to minimum so that ongoing blood loss may not be there. Inform the doing doctor, whoever has done the procedure. And then maybe some many a times changing the position of needle or another puncture will sort out the issue. It may happen because maybe sometimes momentum or some structure after, then we are bleeding. So whenever there is a bleeding, don't be in panic. Stop the temporary infusion and then do that. Okay, GI bleed. The GI bleed usually starts from emergency room. What all staff has to do? Large bowel IV cannula is compulsory whenever there is a bleeding from any site, including trauma patients or any GI bleed patients. First thing, we have to assess the severity. Before that, we have to make sure that airway protection is proper or not. Severity assessment is usually done by emergency doctor or doctor treating them, but pulse will be monitoring and orthostatic hypotension. Orthostatic hypotension in ER, many a time I have reported, or if you want to do, you do it. Do the blood pressure in supine position. Make sure the patient sit with hanging leg, or if patient can stand, okay, bleeding patient, you may not make him stand beside the bed, but after, keep the bed in a 45 or 90 degree position, let the patient sit, and then again check the blood pressure. If there is a drop down of more than 10 millimeter of systolic, then it is a significant. ROCCO scoring chart to be kept in file, because as a JCI standard protocol, we keep that form in the file and we have to fill up that pre and post endoscopy. So ROCCO scoring chart has to be kept. I usually do not advocate to put a rice tube in a GI bleed patient, because in a cirrhotic patient, whenever there are rices, if rice tube cause damage, then there will be more bleeding. Usually in emergency, I do not ask anyone to put rice tube. We treat patient and stabilize them, then only do endoscopy and watch for melina. Now, many a time I receive a call from ward, melina. What is the melina? That is a big question mark. See, melina is a damar one, road banana or damar. I usually speak the word damar, tar. That is melina, black, tarry, foul swelling. That is shiny. You can see this picture. This is a melina. Don't confuse with green stool. And usually melina will, whenever patient of bleeding is there, there will be liquid stool. It will not be hard stool. That patient cannot say I have constipation. If a patient says, or patient says there is a black stool, ask first question, is it a hard stool or it is a diarrhea? If it is a diarrhea, then there is a GI bleed, you can say. But if patient says I have a constipation and black stool, then you can take it lightly. Okay, whenever doctor is there and round, we'll inform that. That's fine. Melina patients will have black stool, liquid stool, semi-formed stool, house swelling, even sticky, shiny. That are the characteristics. Blood transfusion usually we do. As per you have to do as per instruction, and under transfusion is always better than we do. And ask every patient of GI bleed who are admitted about the color of stool, that whenever you are there in the round in the morning when you are checking pulse BP, or whenever 3 times blood pressure pulse rate are checked, at the time ask. Any episode of hematemesis or melina, inform treating doctor immediately whatever is the time. Whatever is the time. Unless it is mentioned that patient is already endoscopy done, there is the bed ligation done, and then patient may have melina for 3 days. If patient stable, need not to call at night, or otherwise calls can be taken accordingly. Hemoglobin monitoring. Most of the patient of upper GI bleed in cirrhosis will be on terbinafine infusion, FFP and albumin as required as per instruction. Prepare patient for endoscopy within 12 hours, not more than 24 hours. Most of the time our patients, we have done endoscopy within 12 hours, but not more than 24 hours. So that is necessary. So any GI bleed patient need not to confirm that we are going to do endoscopy or not. If I have seen many time I receive call in the morning 7 a.m. If I have admitted around 2 o'clock, 7 a.m. they will call whether we are going to do endoscopy. It has to be done. It is the only time that will be decided. Because a patient of cirrhosis with melina or with hematemesis, endoscopy has to be done. There is no other choice to confirm what is the cause and treat the cause accordingly. Many among you may not have seen how endoscopy is done and what all things we see and how we go ahead. I will mention all that. Usually, in general, whenever there is a plan of endoscopy, patient has to be kept fasting for at least 4 to 5 hours duration. If there is a plan in the morning about for endoscopy, if we can receive breakfast at 7 o'clock, how will we do endoscopy at 10 o'clock? That is the most common scenario in our setup. Patient planned for morning endoscopy, so your patient should be in a fasting. At least 4 to 5 hours fasting is required. Diabetes medicine not to give in morning hours. If patient is in a fasting set, blood pressure medicine you can give with 100 ml of water in morning hours, at least 2 hours, 3 hours prior to procedure. Esophageal varices in cirrhosis. What are the varices? May have come across variceal bed ligation and varices seen. These are the veins. You can see this is a bleeding point. It is a impending bleeding point, we can say. These are the varices. This is a normal esophageal mucosa. Okay? So these are the varices. They bleed whenever there is a bleed. Veins will be looking like this. In cirrhotic patient, I mentioned that liver becomes hard, tough. So whenever it is hard, there will be a resistance to flow of blood. So varices will develop. These are the veins. And if there is a bleeding, we do bend ligation. Bend ligation will be like this. Bend ligation. Okay. And post bend ligation, not to dare to put Rydell tube. Okay. Even if instruction given, don't even try to insert Rydell tube without confirmation. Okay. That is a simplest instruction post bend ligation, not to try to put Rydell tube. This is the bend ligation done over the varices. And this is the another picture, that is gastric fundal varices. That we see in stomach, there are varices, and if they bleed, we put a glue, endoscopical glue injection we do. Okay. Any questions? No questions. Everyone knows. Hepatic encephalopathy. Now, what all care has to be done in hepatic encephalopathy? Hepatic encephalopathy treatment will remain as per the doctor's instruction. Large bowline cannula has to be inserted while tube insertion. We do in that patient because we have to give lactulose dose. RT insertion once done, and do aspiration. If there is any aspiration, then depending on that, decision can be taken. Lactulose we have to give through Rydell tube. What is the dose? Usually 30 ml every 2 hours till patient passes stools. Once the patient will pass stools, then reduce the dose 8 hourly or 6 hourly. And in that case, is even watch for melina. Any cirrhotic patient who are in ICU, do look for melina. And in cirrhotic patients who are in encephalopathy, grade 3 or grade 4, tracheal secretions, we have to definitely check. And if needed, suction has to be done. Lactulose enema or lactulose bowel wash. How to give that lactulose enema, that everybody must be knowing. Or many a time, mostly the time it is usually word by after a helper. Monitor urine output and catheter care is the same for hepatic encephalopathy, but do supervise the lactulose enema insertion. Whenever a person is doing enema, we have to take care we do not damage mucosa and perianal region and we induce the bleed. So that thing has to be taken care. This is all common things that we have in patient with hepatic encephalopathy. Never give any sedative without confirmation. Okay, that is another important thing. In a patient in the hepatic encephalopathy, once stable, conscious patient comes to the ward, late cirrhotic patients have usually complained, ऊंघ आती नहीं, बेदिवस्ती ऊंघ क्यों नहीं. Don't dare to give benzodiazepine by mistake even. Okay, without confirmation, or don't do that one. कड़ियों का दरार तेरे patient complain कर 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 तो दबाजू वाला patient दिलाई ना भी देगा. Don't do that. Okay, cirrhotic patient, no benzodiazepine, no sedatives without confirmation. Okay, this is all from my side. For nursing care, if you have any questions, please ask me.